Life Audio.
Let's face it, sometimes, you know, you're talking about the brain and the physical causes. Sometimes we're anxious for a reason. Sometimes it's a valid thing. I mean, David was being pursued. He was having to fight for his life, that kind of thing, before he ascended. And oh boy, 1 and 2 Samuel will tell you all about his plights. But you're not supposed to live in anxiety every day.
How to connect with us.
I'm Carol McCracken.
And I'm Jennifer Slattery.
And I'm wondering, do you ever have random bursts of anxiety that seem to hit without any understandable cause? Or do you ever feel like your emotional response to something is maybe more intense than the situation warrants? When this happens, we might assume that our fear and our anxiety has no understandable cause, and therefore we shouldn't be anxious, and there's nothing we can do. This also means we don't believe God can or will give us freedom in this area. But He is the God of life who promised to lead His children to thriving life.
Amen. And to our listeners who can't see the video portion of this, when she was talking, the reason she was laughing is I'm over here raising my hand. I'm like, do you ever experience that? I'm like, yes, I do. So, I grew up in a family with a long history of anxiety on both sides. And I was taught not to try to give it a cause. And I'm thinking, okay, well, it must be biological because I see it on this side of the family. I see it on this side of the family. And so I figured, well, that I'm just an anxious person. I'm going to be anxious the rest of my life. And I didn't realize that my anxiety, it was in part learned. And I also didn't realize that a lot of it came from wounds from my past that I hadn't really processed. And connected with that, from a highly trained amygdala, so that's the emotional response part of our brain that helps us survive, the fight or flight, that's where it comes from. And so I had a highly trained amygdala that remained alert to potential threat. And I found increased peace as I became curious regarding my emotions and as I asked God to help me get to the root of them. And initially, I do want to warn some of our listeners who maybe are in that same place. Initially, that actually, when I would try to journal about certain things, certain wounds and my reactions, my anxiety escalated pretty high. And so I had to simultaneously, as I was kind of digging into some of those things that we like to keep buried for a really long time, I had to simultaneously learn ways and practice ways to calm my amygdala. And I spent a lot of time doing that. So like deep breathing, tapping, and you can Google that, tapping activities that engaged my thinking brain. So when I was anxious, I would maybe go through the alphabet, A, avocado, B, banana, C, cherries. And what that does is it shifts when our anxiety rises, often it turns off our thinking brain and then it feels more intense. But if we can shift to things that counting or spelling that engages our thinking brain, which quiets our amygdala. And so I had to learn to do some of those things. And as I began to practice retraining my amygdala, unpacking some of those wounds that were buried, their effect over me decreased. And I began also to sense and to rest in God's presence when I've learned to do that, when I feel anxious or afraid.
So you use that as a tool still today?
Correct. Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
Well, so you're saying then that anxiety never goes away?
Well, I don't know about that. But for me, I still have anxiety, but there are a lot more portion of my day where I don't. Okay. And when I do have anxiety, I know how to quiet it.
And that's what I like, because I'm anxious too. And sometimes you're like, this is out of control sometimes. And if you have a coping mechanism, the reason I bring that up is my son suffers from anxiety attacks.
That's hard.
Attacks. You can get caught up in a circle of it. So I think it's scary to think, oh, anxiety never goes away. But if you've got tools to manage it,
right,
you're telling us that it is a physical thing. People
right.
have it. So that's really helpful. Thank you for sharing that. I don't think you're the only one. Like we were saying before, I think that anxiety probably goes back all the way into the Old Testament in our series of bold prayer, we've kind of been examining David, the shepherd boy who turned into a king. And he had a lot of things that he could feel anxious about. I mean, he had to run for his life at some point. It was God was preparing him to be king. And he gives a lot of verses in his Psalms that you could pray as a bold prayer to go along with some of the physical exercises that you were talking about. I'd like to look at Psalm 139 today, if we could, because this is where David, he's very anxious. And how does he set up trust to God? How does somebody handle that? Over and over again, David turns to God for help. And he's written, you know, the Psalms have every emotion you could probably go through. And so Psalm 139 kind of sets up some intimacy that is needed. And basically what David is doing is asking God to search him. And I'd like to read a few of them. Let's begin at one, if you don't mind. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know where I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You're familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. And I just love the intimacy there. David likes that. He's inviting God in. He's saying, help me trust you, Lord. You know about me anyway. Search me. You know what my thoughts are. I find some comfort in that. Have you ever invited God in like that?
Yeah, well, that's been so. Just to clarify, I am a lifelong in therapy. I don't know what you'd use it, but so I will be in therapy for the rest of my life. Maybe that's my joke, but it might be true. I don't know. But that's one thing I really appreciate about my therapist is it doesn't matter what we're talking about. It is highly focused on. She's like, well, what does God say about that? Where was God during that? How does, you know, and it's just a reminder to bring him in to my struggle. I mean, he's already there, right? Yeah. So it's more, like you said in the last episode, it's more of increasing my awareness of who he is, of his greatness. It's like, you know me, you know everything I'm doing, everything I'm thinking, you know what I'm going to do tomorrow. And so it's that complete to be fully known and deeply loved. That combination is so powerful.
Well, it makes it less scary. You know, if you are inviting someone to examine you thoroughly, that kind of is like, ooh, test me. What if I don't pass? It's very vulnerable.
Yes, yes.
But God already knows us.
Amen.
So, you know, what are we so scared of?
Right. And I think that's a process for some of our listeners. If you maybe are just kind of like, I don't even know who this Jesus guy is, or maybe you're new to discovering who he is. We understand that feeling of vulnerability because, as we said in last episode, we live in a punitive culture, and so we can assume that God is punitive as well. He's not, but that can be a learning, right? To learn to receive his grace. And speaking of getting to parts of us, to the root cause of anxiety that maybe we're not aware of, maybe we don't recognize, well, there is a trigger or this is trained or whatever it is. David says this prayer that I think is really helpful when we're trying to better understand ourselves and to invite God's revelation, his wisdom and perspective of whatever we're going through. And this is verses 23 to 24. David wrote, "Search me, God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." And Carol, you already talked about the vulnerability, right, that this requires, and how God already knows us.
Yes, and we're inviting him to test us. But this, when you frame it with those verses, okay, go ahead, test me. You're working with me. Help me get these thoughts out if they're there. Help me have the appropriate perspective, if you will. I think it helps get away from the dysfunctional anxiety because let's face it, sometimes, you know, you're talking about the brain and the physical causes. Sometimes we're anxious for a reason. Sometimes it's a valid thing. I mean,
yes.
David was being pursued. He was having to fight for his life, that kind of thing, before he ascended. And oh boy, 1st and 2nd Samuel will tell you all about his plights. But you're not supposed to live in anxiety every day.
We can't. Our brain can't handle that. Like our body cannot handle that.
How to connect with us.
Anxiety. What if it's dysfunctional? I mean, what if it's like our feelings of I'm not enough, being ashamed? You know, many of us have spent a long time trying to be something that we're not. And maybe it's because we're having a hard time accepting ourselves. And I don't want to cross the line into therapy. I mean, that's not it. But God created us in our emotions. So if He created us in our emotions, we need to turn to Him, the very creator of those things, to help with some right thinking. You got into therapy, you know. Am I crossing the line there?
No, and I think our listeners know we are not therapists, but we do value therapy and we do need, but God is in everything, right? God, so it's recognizing whether we are pursuing help through therapy or whether maybe from a pastor or a friend. I think it's helpful to reach out to others in some way and to share what we're feeling. And I just want to talk about, so getting to the root of anxiety. None of these scripture, like when we read scripture, I think sometimes we think, okay, I'm going to pray this prayer. I'm going to memorize this verse or go to this study and boom, everything will be great.
Right.
And a lot of times getting to the root of our anxieties, that takes time because sometimes there's a lot of different layers to it. And so let's look at your example of feeling like we're insufficient. And maybe we can see, okay, well, in this situation, I feel insufficient because I have as much money as somebody else in the group, or maybe I don't have as much education. And so that would be the first layer, right? And then we can dig a little deeper and, okay, well, I grew up feeling like I was never enough, or maybe I grew up with critical comments. And so it's kind of like we go from one layer to another layer. So I just want to say that to our listeners to encourage them. God is leading us to freedom, but it's a journey.
And it takes time is what you're saying.
Yes.
I hate things that take time. Why do things have to take time?
I know. Well, and in our last episode, we talked about the verse in John 10, verse 10, which tells us, so it says, I'm going to repeat it now. The thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. And Jesus said, but I came that you might have life and have it to the full. And so I'm reminded from the day we are born, we do have a spiritual enemy that is determined to distract, deceive, discourage, defeat us. And he will attack our identity from the moment we are born because our identity resembles Jesus Christ. We are made in God's image. And so the devil will attack, and he will attack every good and precious thing within us. So like if we are gifted in a way, that will often be a big part of our pain journey because the enemy will try to attack that. But then so we have that force throughout our life, but then we have simultaneously, God is working to restore and to transform us to who he created us to be, which goes back to the beginning of Psalm 139, right? God doesn't just know us now.
Right.
He knows us when he formed us. He knows the plans he had for us when he formed us in our mother's womb before the devil began trying to defeat us. And he knows who we're going to be tomorrow and in 5 years and in 10 years. And I just love that image.
Well, so he's in our past. He's in our present and he's in our future.
Amen.
I love that. So he's not bound by time and he sees our potential no matter what happens. And so where it is natural to be anxious, it's not where God intends for us to stay.
Amen. Amen. So let's talk about some practical ways, Carol. Like if somebody's wanting to get, so they say this prayer, see if there's any anxious way in me, which is an invitation, like, Lord, show me where I am not experiencing the fullness of your life, the life that you died to give me. So what are some ways we can do that? After we've said that prayer, how can we get to the root of our anxiety?
Well, I'm going to steal from you because I understand that you journal a lot, don't you?
I do. Tell me. I try to.
Well, you're a busy woman. So how do you get that in? What does that do for you?
Yeah. So the way I journal, actually, my therapist, so much of what I say here, actually, I get in therapy and I just bring to you guys. So you're getting free, free way. But she was a missionary prior. And so she has just a great spiritual toolbox that she pulls from. And she calls it Emmanuel journaling, where it's you're journaling like you're writing letters to God, and then you pause and you try to hear from God, and then you journal it out. So it's kind of this process where, and I mean, I don't always hear from God, but it's where I'm trying to invite him into that process. And it will depend. So speaking of the amygdala that we talked about before, one thing that my therapist stresses is we need more good stuff to give us resiliency to handle hard stuff. And so a big part of my journaling is not just getting to the roots of my anxiety, but pausing to really thank God.
Ooh.
And for what he's done, who he is. And so I start with usually about a paragraph of thanking him. And then I go into whatever, and it will depend on, so getting to the root, if I'm journaling, well, let's say if I react strongly, if I become really defensive about something. And one of the ways I tend to get defensive, I have ADHD, or at least I've been told by those who know me, I have ADHD. I've never been diagnosed, but I can become defensive if someone's like, well, you didn't communicate this, or if I communicate incorrectly or inefficiently. And I can feel defensiveness rise up within me. And so then I will pause and journal on that. What is the root? Why am I feeling so defensive in this situation? And so so a lot of it will be recognizing, okay, I reacted strongly in this instance. Let's reflect upon that. When I have time, prayerfully invite God, what was really going on there?
Because it was more than just that. So would you call that a trigger?
Yeah, I think you could call that a trigger, and we all have them, right?
I know certain things get under my skin, let me tell you. But what helps is in my therapy, naming it. Don't judge that feeling that comes up, because I can help anybody with their feelings, but it's difficult for me when I have the feelings and naming what it is. And that's a source of my anxiety. Okay, why am I feeling this? What caused this? And I immediately want the why. And it's like, okay, just name it. You reacted. You're mad. Call it mad. Why are you mad? If you don't know right now, don't judge it. Move on until you can come back to it. So I love anything that'll help me with my toolbox.
Yeah. Well, I know you're really big. So Carol actually is on staff at a church. And so you do a lot with small group as well, right?
Yes. And that is a good circle of trust. A small group is something, you know, there are some that really flourish. There are some people that just don't make the connection. But a connection at some point is so very helpful to you not going through life alone. It's a stability.
Yeah.
Don't have a small group yet, a stable friend to establish trust and to even call you out on things or help you work through something, it really helps. But I have seen people really flourish. I mean, there are people going through divorce. There are people that have children misbehaving. You hold each other up. And hopefully in that group, not everybody's going through something at the same time, but you're going to go through something that's going to cause anxiety. And if you've got support, people that pray for you, you get to pray for others. That gets you out of your own head and realizing you're not the only one going through things. Other people are too. But I highly recommend groups and a trusted friend. Don't keep it inside. Don't isolate. Don't try to solve your own problems when you're anxious, because you might not have perspective.
Right. And then I would also encourage prayer is always a great when you're in the middle of, and this is a series on bold prayers. So right. We're hoping that you can practice some of these scriptural prayers, you can pray them. And when we pray, again, you talked about getting out of your head. It reminds us, if nothing else, one, it brings us into the presence of God.
Yes.
And often can help us be more, he's always there, but helps us be more aware of his presence. And when we pray things like search me, know me, whatever, we're engaging our thinking brain, which quiets our amygdala. We're reminding ourselves of who God is, that he's with us, that we're not alone, that he's bigger than whatever we're facing. And I think that really helps as well. Like knowing to know we're not alone in this helps.
There's comfort too in being seen and known, and then you are not alone wrestling this thing, whatever the thing may be.
I love that. To our listeners, thank you for listening. We hope that this gave you another tool in your toolbox as you are pursuing the life that Jesus is calling you to, empowering you to receive. Keep on the journey. We would love to hear from you. Reach out to us through our website or social media to let us know how God used this episode to encourage or inspire you. And let us know if you share this episode or other episodes so that we can thank you here on our podcast. As an additional way to show our appreciation for your support, we are doing a fun giveaway. Yeah, we are giving away some t-shirts that have messages on them designed to help you experience greater peace, to remind you of who you are in Christ. And the first one says, fighting fear with faith. Another t-shirt says, fully known, wholly loved, and sufficiently empowered. And then the third t-shirt says, a different kind of peace. And again, each of these are designed to remind us of who we are in Christ, what we have in him. And you can enter two ways. The first is by sharing your favorite Faith Over Fear episode on social media or to someone by email. When you do, make sure to take a screenshot, take a picture, and then send that to us through our website. You can also enter by leaving us an honest review in your podcast app. And then again, sending us a screenshot and sending that to us through our contact page on our website so that we have your email, so that we can see it, and we have your email to contact you should you win.
Yay, we want to get it to you, most definitely. They're cute t-shirts, y'all.
And again, thank you for listening. Keep moving forward in the journey, knowing that God will bring you to your destination.